Also adios. نعم. اللهم إنك قلت وقولك الحق المبين ومن أحسن قولا ومن أحسن من الله حديثا ومن أحسن من الله قيلا قل صدق الله فاتبعوا ملة إبراهيم حنيفا وما كان من المشركين اللهم لا علم لنا إلا ما علمتنا إنك أنت العليم الحكيم اللهم علمنا ما ينفعنا وانفعنا بما علمتنا إنك أنت العليم الحكيم صلى الله على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم أما بعد we thank Almighty Allah for bringing us together for today's tafsir we pray to Almighty Allah to grant us understanding and grant us increase in knowledge and faith and to reward us with goodness in this life and in the hereafter Ameen. Today inshallah we will be talking about the rights of children, the rights of children in the laws of Islam. We usually hear about the rights of parents over the children. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala rightly revealed to Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in multiple places in the Quran, the rights of parents over children. He made it very clear that parents have an indisputable right, inalienable right over their children, and that the rights of parents over children are unconditional. The child must obey the parents. The child must respect the parents, no matter what the circumstances are. The only time a child is allowed to disobey the parents is if the parent is asking the child to worship anything else besides Allah. Beyond that, the scholars looked at it and they said, why in so many places Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talked about the rights of the parents over the child in the Quran, but there's no specific place where Allah is talking to the parents about the child that's in the same manner that he did for the child about the parents. Allah did not talk about the child's right to the parents in the same manner. For example, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the Quran would say something like, وَوَصَّيْنَا الْإِنسَانَ بِوَالِدَيْهِ حُسْنًا وَوَصَّيْنَا الْإِنسَانَ بِوَالِدَيْهِ إِحْسَانًا وَوَصَّيْنَا الْإِنسَانَ بِوَالِدَيْهِ حَمَلَتْهُ أُمُّهُ كَرْهًا and things like that we have enjoined the children, بِوَالِدَيْهِ. We have enjoined the child about his parents. Allah describes how the mother toiled upon the child when she carried the pregnancy to term and gave birth to the child, how much trouble the mother went through. But Allah never described about the child that same way to the parents. The same way Allah also said, وَقَدَ رَبُّكَ أَلَّا تَعْبُدُوا إِلَّا إِيَّا وَبِالْوَالِدَيْنِ إِحْسَانًا, that we have made compulsory upon you to worship none but Allah. وَبِالْوَالِدَيْنِ إِحْسَانًا, and that to your parents you should do good. Allah made it very clear to the child and he gave him many other conditions that he has to fulfill as part of the rights of the parents. So the scholars agreed that Allah did not specify to the child, to the parents, the same way he specified to the child. The reason being that the child is absent from the times when the parents were working very hard on his behalf. The child is incapable of understanding the full extent of the sacrifice that the parents made for him. That's why Allah had to remind him, tell him about how his mother carried him for 9 months and how his mother breastfed him for 2 years, for those who breastfeed for 2 years. So Allah had to remind him of that, to tell him why he has to be grateful to them. Then Allah enjoined him to be grateful to them. But it is different for the parents, because the parents were there from the beginning of this child. And it is the natural instinct of the parent to love the child that they give birth to. So they don't need to be reminded of that. They understand the importance of that child. They love the child naturally. For those who Allah has given that mercy to be able to feel, to have that feeling for their children, they already have that feeling. Allah does not need to remind them of that feeling of loving their child. That's natural for them. Of training their child, that is natural for them. Of wanting the best for their child, that is natural for them. That is for someone whose natural instinct is not broken. But basically, that is how it is. And that is the consensus of the scholars on that. Now, we also know that having a child is not just having a child. it is a responsibility for every parent. You have a child, now you have an extra mouth to feed. And then, you know, you have an extra body to clothe. You have all this amount of responsibilities on these children. But what does Islam say about the rights of the children over the parents in specific terms? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Surah Al-Tahrim, it says, Ya ayyuhal lazina amanu. Because we want to know that when you have a child, you have taken upon yourself an extra responsibility. This extra responsibility you have taken upon yourself, even though it makes you very happy at the time when you have that child, you should also know that this child that you just have is a blessing from Allah on the one hand, is a gift from Allah on the one hand, but it could also be the reason you go to paradise or the reason you go to hellfire. Allah says in Surah Al-Tahrim, verse 6, Ya ayyuhal lazina amanu, ku anfusakum wa alikum nara, wa alikum naran, wa kudu an-nas wal hijara, alayha malaikatun gilazun shidadun, la yahsuna Allah amarahum, wa yafu'aluna ma yu'marun. Oh, you will believe. Be careful. Care for yourself. Ward yourselves and your families against fire. It is your responsibility to ward yourselves and your families against fire. It is your responsibility to preach to your family including your wives or your husbands and your children. They are your family. It becomes your responsibility to guide them away from Allah's wrath, away from fire to paradise, away from what Allah is displeased by to what Allah is pleased with. That is, if you neglect this duty, on the day of Qiyamah, the child will be telling Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that punish my parents because they are the ones that did not teach me what they're supposed to teach me. Punish my parents because they are the ones that did not show me the way to you, Allah, because it is their duty and they failed in that duty. So if you fail in that duty, it could be a cause for one to find the wrath of Allah on the day of judgment. So you might have done very well for yourself, but if you fail to guide your children, that is, you're lacking in that place, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala could punish you for that on the day of Qiyamah. وَفِي الْوَقْتِ نَفْسُهُ يَكُونُ الْوَلَدُ سَبَبًا فِي دُخُولِكَ الْجَنَّةِ كَمَا قَالَ. In the same vein, the child can be the reason that you make paradise. The Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, يُقُسِ وَالِدَ حَامِلِ الْقُرْآنِ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ تَاجَ الْوِقَارِ الْيَقُوتَةِ فِيهِ خَيْرٌ مِنَ الدُّنْيَا وَمَا فِيهَا. He said, on the day of Qiyamah, the parent of the one that has memorized the Quran will be crowned with a golden crown. So just sending your child to study Arab, to study the Quran, to memorize the Quran and know it properly and be able to read it properly and understand the religion could be just what Allah will use to forgive you on the day of Qiyamah and count you amongst the inmates of Jannah. So the children could be the key. Your child could be the key for success or for failure in the sight of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The rights of the child over the parent begin way before the child is born. There are the rights that you have to fulfill for the child before they are born. So for the single folks on listening right now, those who are not yet married, you have work to do also in terms of fulfilling the rights of your future children. And for those who already have children, for those who are still having children, you have to fulfill the rights of your children before they are conceived, in fact, before you get married. For the men, the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Tunka'u al-mar'a li-arba'in." Women are married for four things. It is enjoined upon everyone that wants to get married, again, as part of your preparation for the rights of your children unborn. You have to take care when you are choosing your partner, the one with whom you want to build a family, the one with whom you want to have children. You have to choose the right partner because it begins from there. If you choose the wrong partner, you are planting a seed on a bad soil. It will not germinate anything than a bad seed. So when your child comes out wrong, it will be your fault because you chose the wrong partner to begin with. So you're a Muslim and you're marrying someone who does not believe in Allah, who does not have faith in Allah, who is doing other things besides Allah, who does not understand Tawheed. You're setting your future children up for failure, whether you're a man or you're a woman. The Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam admonished men and he told them that tunka'ul mar'a li-arba'in, that women are married for four things. Women are generally married for four things. Limaliha, some people marry women because of the money that they have. Walihasabiha, Some people marry women because of their background, because of their family, the influence. Dangote's daughter, Bill Gates' daughter, you want to marry her for that. People marry for that reason. And it's a valid reason too. Wali Jamaliha, people marry women because of the beauty that they have. Wali Diniha, the prophet also said that people marry women for their understanding of religion, for their standing in religion, for their knowledge of religion. And the prophet emphasized and said, فَزْفَرْ بِزَاتِ دِينِ تَرْبَتْ يَدَكَ. But select the pious ones. Take care, watch carefully the ones that have the deen. Select carefully the one that is weightier in terms of the deen, that understands the deen more, that has more points in terms of the deen than any other criteria you're setting out for yourself. Set out 4 criteria, but set out of those 4, the last one, which is the religion part of it, the religious part, marry a religious person, someone who understands the Quran. Let your minimum be that the person at least knows how to read the Quran. And then you can take it from there. And maybe your minimum can be that the person understands the wordings of the Quran. That is, they can read it and they can translate it and understand it comfortably. You can put your, you can raise your standard to that extent. And let's stop making our standards any of all those other criteria, like money, like beauty. Let's not base our criteria on those. We're setting ourselves up for failure. The Prophet has advised us to watch out, especially for the deen part, the religious part of the person you want to choose as your wife. For the women folks, the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam also had an admonition for them. He said, إِذَا خَطَبَ إِلَيْكُمْ مَنْ تَرْضَوْنَ دِينَهُ وَخُلُقَهُ فَزَوِّجُوهُ. If someone approaches you, whether you yourself, the woman, or your wali, your father, someone approaches either one of you, if it's the father, someone approaches you that they want to marry your daughter. Or if you're the woman, someone approaches you that they want to marry you. تَرْضَوْنَ دِينَهُ وَخُلُقَهُ. When you look at this person, you see in them that they are religious. You see in them that they have sound understanding of the religion. That which is the most important. You already find that one in them. وَخُلُقَهُ. You also see that they have strong character. You have religion and strong character in a man, strong combination, and this man is asking to marry you, the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam say, don't even think about anything else. Don't waste another minute in accepting that person's proposal. If you're the father, just let them move ahead to get married already. If you are the woman that they are asking now, if you've seen this combination in a man that he fears Allah, he understands the religion properly, he has sound knowledge of the religion, and he has strong personal character, the Prophet said, فَزَوِّجُوهُ. إِن لَمْ تَفَعَلْ تَكُنْ فِتْنَةٌ وَفَسَادٌ عَرِيدٌ. Because if you do not, if you start looking for other things that are not lost, if you start looking for other criteria, it has to have PhD, it has to have BSc. After you found this two combination, this very rare combination of two things in that person, you now start looking for other things. It needs to have $1 million in the account. It needs to have this. It needs to have that. The Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, This would be the cause of great, great mischief and fitna in the land. And that is what we're seeing today, brothers and sisters. That is why we have a lot of women, a lot of sisters who are of marriage age, who are of marriageable age that are not yet married, because they don't know what to look out for. Or they know what to look out for, but they're looking for that which is not necessary. The most important thing to look for in a man is a combination of the religion and that of the strong character. Imam Hassan al-Basri, someone asked him one day that, I have a daughter of marriageable age. What kind of man should I give her out to? And Imam Hassan said to him, if you will give out your daughter to any person, give your daughter out to someone who has the fear of Allah, who knows, who understands religion, understands the fear of Allah and fears Allah. Because if you marry your daughter out to someone who fears Allah, understands the basic tenets of religion and fears Allah, at the minimum, if their love continues to grow, it will continue to love her and walk with her with the fear of Allah. It will continue to live with her with the fear of Allah. It will not cheat her, it will not act against her or over her or on her out of the will of Allah. But if things go sour between them, maybe they have a fight, maybe they have a disagreement, The only quality this person has is the fear of Allah. He has a disagreement with his wife, your daughter. You can be sure that he still will not cheat your daughter. You can be sure that even though he's angry at your daughter or they're having a fight, he still will not do wrong by your daughter. Because he's not dealing with your daughter, he will be dealing with Allah. And he fears Allah, he will be scared to do anything wrong with your daughter. He will continue to uphold all of our rights. Because that is the most important thing, the fear of Allah in that person. But again, brothers and sisters, okay, sorry about that. Okay, so yeah, so if today, let us ask ourselves, we have fathers on the call, we have sisters on the call. How many of us are looking at the right criteria? We have brothers too on the call. How many of us are looking at the right criteria and staying on those right criteria only, not looking at what the society has dictated for them as new rules, the rules that are not necessary? Are we focusing on what is necessary? And this is the first step we have to take in fulfilling the rights of our unborn children. So this is for two people who are not yet married, who are just beginning the process. You have to take care of this. This is the first thing you have to take care of to be fulfilling the right of your children unborn. Now, having said that, so you have gotten married, you have done the right thing, you have chosen a great partner for yourself, man or woman. The next thing in fulfilling the right of your child is to understand that the next right of the child that Islam protects is Haqqul Hayat. Haqqul Hayat, the right to life for the child. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah Al-An'am, verse 151, وَلَا تَقْتُلُوا أَوْلَادَكُمْ مِنْ إِمْلَاقٍ نَحْنُ نَرْزُقُكُمْ وَإِيَّاهُمْ. And do not kill your children out of poverty, out of fear of poverty. Do not murder your children out of fear of poverty. نَحْنُ نَرْزُقُكُمْ وَإِيَّاهُمْ. It is us. It is we, Allah, that will provide your sustenance for you, and we will take care of their own sustenance too. Don't worry about, I don't have money. Money or wealth should not be the reason that one is killing off their offspring. Killing or murder in this case will be in any way that it comes. You can call it any name that you call it today. Call it contraception if you will. Call it abortion if you will. Call it anything you will. Islam does not allow anyone to, if poverty is your sole reason for doing it, it's not a medical reason or anything else, but poverty, it is forbidden in Islam. Directly by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Surah Al-An'am, verse 151, where he says, وَلَا تَقْتُلُوا أَوْلَادَكُمْ مِنْ إِمْلَاقٍ. Do not kill your children out of poverty. نَحْنُ نَرْزُقُكُمْ وَإِيَّاهُمْ. It is us that provide your sustenance and we will take care of their sustenance also. He also said in Surah Al-Isra, verse 31, وَلَا تَقْتُلُوا أَوْلَادَكُمْ خَشْيَةْ إِمْلَاكٍ نَحْنُ نَرْزُقُهُمْ وَإِيَّاكُمْ إِنَّ قَتْلَهُمْ كَانَ خِتَأً كَبِيرًا. Do not kill your children out of fear of poverty. Don't say, I have enough. If I have one more, we will not be able to feed. I have not fed the ones in the house. I won't be able to feed the next one. No, it is not you that is feeding them. It is Allah that provides sustenance. As long as you fulfill all of the rights of Allah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has promised, he has said it directly, that he is in charge of your own sustenance as a person. He has been in charge of your sustenance since the time you were born. He's still in charge of your sustenance now that you think that you are working and you're making money. And he will continue to be in charge of your sustenance. And your child is born the same way you were born, that Allah has been in charge of your sustenance. Allah says it will be in charge of your child's sustenance also. Poverty should not be the reason why you do not procreate. Brothers and sisters, inna qatlahum kana khita'an kabira. Allah says, surely killing your children out of poverty, killing your children out of fear of poverty, kana khita'an kabira, is a great sin. It is a great sin. And then another thing is, injabul unsa hibbatan min Allah. Injabul unsa hibbatan min Allah. Knowing within yourself, and this one is a bias that many of us have and that we have to be careful about. Knowing that having female children is a gift from Allah. Not seeing female children as being inferior to male children. not looking disdain when one has female children. Let them call you your Abigail. Let them call you Baba Abigail. That is the society. That is them speaking. Do not feel sad when you have female children. Do not be like those people in the time of Jahiliya and the time of the Dark Ages, the Arab Dark Ages before the time of Islam. Every time before Islam is considered Jahiliya, because this is the time that people did not have knowledge of Allah and they were just doing things that they wish or rules that they brought upon themselves that was imposed on them by the society. Back then in the Jahiliya times, it was known that female children were inferior, but the manner in which they reacted to the inferiority of female children is different from the manner we reacted to it today. At that time, if a man has a female child, say a person, his wife gives birth to a female child, he asks them, what did she give birth to? And they tell him it's a female child. He's going to tell them that, this is not a good child to have, because the help that we got, you know, there were men who had horses, and horses was what showed wealth and influence. And then men go to war at those times. And then he would say to them that, listen, the only help she can render me if I'm going to war is to weep. And she's useless to me. She can't help me carry my sword. She can't help me get on my horse when I'm getting ready for war. She can only weep, and that will tie me down. And also, the only assistance you give to me in terms of money will be money that she steals from her husband's house. They don't see her as someone that can make her own money, have her own sustenance, have her own money. So the father thinks that even if his daughter grows old, gets married, and, you know, turns around to help him out, give him something, she'll be giving him from money she probably stole from her husband. So they just had that disdain for girl children, for female children back in those days before Islam came. And Islam liberated the girl children, the women. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in Surah Ash-Shura, where he's warning us, when he's telling us about his majesty, making us understand that male or female, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one that created both of them. And if you're having a male child, it is Allah's will that you have a male child. And if you're having a female child, it is Allah's will that you have a female child. There are many people on earth today that don't have any. There are many people who have male children, but they wish that they had female children. So if you have female children, be thankful to Allah. That is part of the rights of the children that you have to fulfill when you start having children. Allah says, Surah Ash-Shura, verse 49, لِلَّهِ مُلْكُ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ يَخْلُقُ مَا يَشَاءُ يَهَبُ لِمَنْ يَشَاءُ إِنَاثًا وَيَهَبُ لِمَنْ يَشَاءُ ذُكُورًا. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to him belongs the kingdoms of the heavens and the earth. He creates what he wills. He bestows female offsprings upon whom he wills, and he bestows male offsprings upon whom he wills. It is the will of Allah. We accept the will of Allah because we're Muslims, because we submit ourselves totally to the will of Allah. It doesn't speak well for a Muslim that Allah gives a gift to you and you complain about that gift. It doesn't speak well to a Muslim that Allah gives a gift to you and you dislike that gift. You need to open your heart to accept the gift of Allah and be thankful to him, so that you do not end up becoming a kafir, an ungrateful person in the sight of Allah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu Allah says in Surah An-Nahl, verses 58 and 59, وَإِذَا بُشِّرَ أَحَدُهُمْ بِالْأُنْثَى ظَلَّ وَجْهُهُ مُسْوَدًّا وَهُوَ كَظِيمٌ يَتَوَارَى مِنَ الْقَوْمِ مِنْ سُوءِ مَا بُشِّرَ بِهِ أَيُمْسِكُهُ عَلَى هُونٍ أَمْ يَدُسُّهُ فِي التُّرَابِ عَلَى سَاءَ مَا يَأْكُلُونَ. Talking about the ones, the Arabs during the time of Jahiliyyah and during the Dark Ages before Islam, when they are told that they have female children, they kill the female children and they bury them. That's even merciful. The ones that are worse, they will bury the girl child alive, just so that they assure themselves that if they bury the girl child alive, she will not come back. That is, it guarantees them that they don't have another female child. So any female child they have, they will show cruelty by burying them alive. The baby girl child buried alive, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَإِذَا الْمَوْءُودَةُ سُئِلَتْ بِأَيِّ ذَنْبٍ قُتِلَتْ. When the girl child will be asked, For what sin were you murdered? For what sin were you killed? Brothers and sisters, let us not do things that makes us look like those who are ungrateful to Allah during the dark times. Let us not do things like those who acted based on their lack of understanding during the dark times. Islam has come to shine the light. We understand that we accept the gift of Allah and we're thankful to Allah, whichever kind of gift that He gives to us. The Surah An-Nahl, verse 58-59 says, when the news of the birth of a female child is brought to any of them, his face becomes dark and is filled with inward grief. He doesn't like that he has a female child. So brothers and sisters, if it is you, again, if it happens, your wife gives birth to a female child, be thankful to Allah, be glad and be happy for it. Do not be sad about it. Do not complain about it. It is the gift that Allah has given to you. And might be that that is the blessing. That is the one that Allah will use to bless your entire family, if only you know. Having said this, the right of the child to live, I hope we've been clear about that. We cannot kill a child by any means for fear of poverty alone. The next thing we want to talk about, adab-ul-wilada. Adab-ul-wilada, the rules of Islam that parents have to follow for when they have a child. You know, we're bringing it from before you got married, how you get married, your child, your unborn child has a right on you from when you choose your partner to when you conceive the baby. We've talked about conception. Now we're going to talk about when you give birth to the baby. What are the rights of this new baby upon you after you give birth to them, immediately you give birth to them? ذكر الإمام الغزالي في إيائه عدة آداب تتصل بالولادة. Imam al-Ghazali in his book, Ulum Deen, he said, he listed out some things, some steps that one should take immediately they give birth to a baby. The first one, that one should not, when you give birth to a baby, you should not be sad. You should not be too happy if the child is a baby boy, and you should not be too sad if the child is a baby girl. In any case, you should not be too happy at all. You should just be thankful to Allah. Don't become too happy. What we see today, we give birth, we want to show the whole world immediately, but that is not the first things that we need to do. فَإِنَّهُ لَا يَدْرِي الْخِيَرَةُ فِي أَيِّهِمَا فَكَمْ مِنْ صَوْهِبِ إِبْنٍ يَتَمَنَّ أَلَّا يَكُونَ لَهُ أَوْ يَتَمَنَّ أَنْ يَكُونَ بِنْتًا. It says, you don't know how many people have male children, that they blame themselves for having male children. They curse the day that they gave birth to those male children. You that you're saying it's male children you want. God gave you female children that you're angry about, that you're not thankful for. He said, there are many people that have male children, they wish that they didn't have those children, or that they wish that Allah would just replace those children, those male children, for female children for them. But that the benefits from the female child is a lot. So for anyone that Allah gives a female child, one should understand that وَالثَّوَابُ فِيهِنَّ أَجِزَلْ, and that there's a lot of reward from training and raising a female child in the Islamic way. The second one is that أَنْ يُعَزِّنَ فِي أُزُنِ الْوَلَدْ, that if one gives birth to a child, the first thing that you do, one of the first steps you take is to call the adhan in the child's ear. Call the adhan in the child's ear. رُوِيَ رَافِعٍ أَنْ أَبِيهِ قَالَ رَأَيْتُ النَّبِيَّ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ قَدْ أَذَّنَ فِي أُذْنِ الْحُسَيْنِ. It said, this Sahaba says that he saw the Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم call the adhan in the ears of his grandson Hussein. حين ولدته فاطمة رضي الله عنها, when Fatima gave birth to Hussein. وَيُسْتَحَبُّ أَنْ يُلَكِّنُوهُ أَوَّلَ امْتِلَاكِ لِسَانِهِ بِلَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ. And it is also preferred for one that has given birth to a baby. When your baby is given birth to, when they start making sounds, when they start being able to make sounds, because today we find ourselves, the first thing we want to teach our children to say, or our baby to say, is Baba, Father, Baba, Mama. That's what we're looking for the baby to say. But Islamic etiquette dictates that the best thing to do for a child that's beginning to speak is to say to them, La ilaha illallah. Make it be the first thing that they say. Make it be the first words that the child will form by hearing it all the time from you. Be saying it to them, be saying it to them until they can say it back to you. Hopefully that it will be the first word ever that they mutter. La ilaha illallah, the words of faith. I'm saying there's no God but Allah. To be the first thing that the child would say. Adab al-Thalith, the third etiquette, and to samihi isman asanan, fadhalika min haqqil walad. To name the child, give the child a good name. Qala sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, ahabbul asma'i ilallah, the best name, the best of names in the sight of Allah, abdullahi. Name a child Abdullah, that's the best name in the sight of Allah, or wa abdul rahman, or name the child Abdul Rahman. Those two names are the best names that Allah loves the most. Wa qala sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the Prophet also said, innakum tud'auna yawm al-qiyamah bi asma'ikum wa asma'i aba'ikum fa ahsinu asma'akum, that on the day of qiyamah you shall be called by your names and your father's names. You will be called Abdul Aziz bin Tajuddin. You will be called Abdul XYZ bin XYZ. You will be called by your name and your father's name when you are risen to receive judgment on the day of judgment. This is saying that what name would you like to be announced on the speaker on the day of judgment when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is calling everyone for judgment? If you now hear your name, would you be glad about the name? Or if your child is called, thinking about the name that you've given your child, if your child's name is called on the speaker on the day of Qiyamah when all of Allah's creation is gathered, would you be proud of that name? These are kind of things that you think about when you name your child. Anyone that has an undesirable name can change this name, as it was the practice during the time of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that people who have undesirable names, undesirable being names that do not conform with the Islamic tenets, that do not conform with the Sharia, one can change such names. You don't have to keep those names. People will come to the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, accept Islam, and when the Prophet hears their name, he will say, that's not a good name. He will change such name and give them a better name that conforms with the Islamic law. Example will be someone whose name is something like Slow. The Prophet will change that, and that's not a good name to call Slow. Can change that to naming someone that's fast. You know, something that sounds better, that gives you better pride than what you were named before. More so, another very important point to make is that children can be named in any language. The Islamic Sharia does not stipulate specifically specific names that children should be given. It only gives guidelines of what kind of names will conform with the Sharia. And also, it doesn't specify that children should be named in Arabic. It just gives guidelines on the kind of names that one should be given. We could see this. Walam yufrid al-Islam ala al-usrat al-muslima an tusamma awladaha zukuran kanu aw inasan bi asmahin muayyana. It doesn't specify, give a specific name or type of name that you can give your child. It doesn't say when you give birth to a child, you have to name him this. You have to name him this. No, it gives that opportunity, it leaves that, gives the discretion of that to the family, to the father of the child that is born. We give that flexibility to them, but we give guidelines on what kind of names one can be given. The Sheikh Ad-Doktor, what's his name now? In Fiqh al-Usra, page 379, Sheikh Yusuf al-Qardawi, he says, فَيَجُوزُ لِلْمُسْلِمْ أَنْ يُسَمَّ إِبْنَهُ أَوْ إِبْنَتَهُ إِسْمًا عَرَبِيًّا أَوْ أَعْجَمِيًّا. He says that it is acceptable for a Muslim to name his child, his boy child or his girl child, in an Arabic name, or name the child in a foreign language, maybe their local language. Give your child a name in your local language. It is acceptable. مَادَامَ مَعْنَاهُ حَسَنًا, as long as the meaning of that name in that local dialect is good. It's not a bad name. It is a name that conforms with the Islamic Sharia. And then we go out to list what those guidelines are. The first one, أَنْ يَكُونَ الْإِسْمُ حَسَنًا, that the name should be a good name. It should not be a bad name that means, it should not be a name that means something bad. And preferably, it should not be the name of a bad person, of a known bad person also. Number two, Allah yakuna mu'abbadan lighayri Allah, and that the name should not be one that shows servitude to anything besides Allah. It should not be a name like Shangutade, because this is showing servitude to something, a deity that is known, that other, the mushrikun worship this deity. We should not name children. If you're naming, you know, in your dialect, on your tradition, you should be careful not to name to a deity besides Allah. We name children Abdullah, showing servitude to Allah. We don't name children Ogunjimi or Shuntade. It should not be part of the name of a Muslim child. Number three, Allah yuha bil kibri wal azama wa ulwil insan bighayri haqqi. The name should not stipulate or show or denote anything that gives a might or power to a person that they do not have, that you do not have claim to, the kind of power or position I do not have claim to. Example of that is for one to be called by the name that is only attributed to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. For someone to be called Rahim, for someone to be called Rahman, for example, you cannot call someone Rahman, you can only call someone Abdul Rahman. You don't call someone Rahman. And it is said that the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, أَقْنَا الْعِسْمِ إِنْدَ اللَّهِ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ رَجُلٌ تُسَمَّى مَلِكَ الْأَمْلَاكِ لَا مَلِكَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ. The worst name on the day of Qiyamah, when all names are being called, when people are being called by their names, the worst name will be someone that will be announced, that will be called by the name مَلِكُ الْأَمْلَاكِ, the king of kings. But someone will wake up and name their child Molecule Amlak or anything close to that. And the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, this is hateful to Allah. This is not an acceptable kind of name to Allah. This is the worst kind of name if it is announced in the sight of Allah, because La Malika illallah. There is no king. There is no king of kings except Allah. Only Allah is the king of kings. So if someone names his child king of kings, the child is not, no child, no human being is worthy of such name. And so any name that one is not worthy of, that is only an attribute for Allah, no one should claim it, and no one should name a child such a name. Now, the al-adab al-rabi, the fourth etiquette that one should follow when you have a child is al-aqiqah, to slaughter a ram on behalf of that child, and is zakar bishatain, slaughter two rams for a boy child, for a male child, for anil unsa bishatin zakran kanat aw unsa. And for a female child, you slaughter one ram. It could be a male ram or a female ram. You slaughter one for the female child and two for the male child. Al-adab al-khamis, the fifth etiquette is, and you annikahu bi tamratin aw halawatin, is to do tahnik for the child. Tahnik means to chew on maybe something that is sweet, or a date, you chew it until it's very soft or maybe even turn to liquid, and then take the tongue, usually expected of the father of the child or someone who is a good person, that you know is someone that fears Allah, that is a good person in the community, to do this on your behalf. People will bring their children to Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam to do ta'anik for them. Put something that is sweet in the mouth, or a date, chew it until it is close to being a liquid. Use the tongue to touch the baby's tongue. That is called tanik. It's usually done, again, it's a reservation for the father of the child or for a good person or a scholar. It's best to do that because it is used to seek blessings of Allah for that child and protection. Additionally, it is also in other books that one of the things to do for a new child that one gives birth to is to do ruqya for that child every day. Do ruqya, recite the verses of the Quran that we recite for protection over that child. Do azkar, the morning and evening azkars that we do for protection, to seek protection for the child from the day that he is born. This is also some of the etiquettes that should be followed by parents of newborn as part of their rights over you. Because again, he can't do it for himself. It is your job to do it at that time. The next right of the child that we'll talk about in the next few minutes will be haqqu intisab al-walad ila walidayhi. Haqqu intisab al-walad ila walidayhi. The right of the child to be associated to his father, his or her father. The child's right to be associated to the right to his or her father. One that has given birth to a child does not have the right to disclaim that. We don't disclaim a child in Islam. The child has the right to be associated to their father. He has the right to bear your name. He has the right to be known by the community, by the world, that you are the father. It is prohibited for the father of a child to deny the child, because the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Falwalad lilfirosh alwalad lilfirosh." The child belongs to the matrimonial bed. That is, the child belongs to the marriage. That marriage. Any child that is born of a marriage belongs to the marriage. Now, the Islamic Sharia requires that for a marriage to happen, there are certain conditions that have to be met. Example is that the man that wants to marry the woman will give a proposal, the woman would accept. Both of them would agree to marry themselves. No one will be forced upon the other. The man would then give the woman what is called a mahar or a sadaq that the woman would ask for, and the woman would have to accept it. It cannot be imposed on the woman, and it cannot be less than what she asks for. It will be what she asks for, and she would willingly accept that. Acceptance of the mahar or the sadaq is a seal to the contract of marriage for both of them. It gives the man the authority or the permission or the access to have relations with her, to now have sexual relations. So her acceptance of the mahar makes it acceptable for them to have sexual relations amongst themselves. And that's also including all the other conditions for marriage, which we have talked about at other times. Now, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala described the union, you know, after all of the rites have been performed, after all of the conditions of marriage have been met. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala described the ties of marriage as mithaqun galizo. Mithaqun galizo. That is a firm and strong covenant. The moment that you get married and fulfill all the rites and you come together in union, that is, you have sexual relations together, you are tied together in a knot that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala described as a strong covenant. Now, one or the other one of you is not expected to cheat on the other one, especially the woman. The woman has now become a part of the man. She has now become one with that man, even though a man, as we know in Islam, can marry other women. But this woman cannot marry another man while she is still in this strong, firm covenant with the man. So it is expected that there's trust between them. It is expected that the woman would not perform any act of cheating or getting involved with other people while with that man. And so also does the Sharia have a strong expectation of both of them that when the woman conceives a pregnancy, that pregnancy belongs to the man in whom she is in a strong covenant with, and it cannot be for anyone else. So before the time of DNA and all this other technology that we have, when a woman gets pregnant, it cannot be claimed to be the pregnancy of anyone else. That pregnancy and any baby from there is owned by the man, the father, the husband, the one with whom they did akidu nikah, that she has a contract with, that she is in a covenant with, is the absolute owner of the baby, uncontestable. In the days of DNA, we can talk about that later, but the rule of Sharia based on the hadith of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, al-walad lil-firosh, the husband, the one with who has the legal marriage, is the owner of any baby in that marriage. Now, in a case where the man suspects, or maybe even has proof, but he doesn't have proof that meets the Sharia, because the Sharia requires that you have four witnesses. If you're going to accuse someone of zina, you need to have four witnesses. If you don't have four witnesses and you accuse someone of zina, you're liable to punishment. If you accuse someone wrongly of zina, you're liable to punishment of 80 lashes of the cane. But if one is caught committing zina, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in Surah 2, verse 2 and 4, Azaniyat wa zani fajlidu kulla wahidin minhuma miyata jaldatin. For the fornicator, male and female, unmarried male and female, give them 100 lashes of the cane. In the Sharia, if a fornicator that is caught is married, then they are stoned to death. That is the penalty for that. So say the man doesn't have proof, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says you need to have four witnesses for you to have proof. That's the required proof, that you have four witnesses. But you don't have enough proof, you don't have four witnesses, but the man is convinced that he doesn't own the child. A man cannot be forced to take responsibility for a child if he feels strongly is not his child. But invariably, he will be accusing his wife. He will be accusing his wife of fornication. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَالَّذِينَ يَرْمُونَ أَزْوَاجَهُمْ وَلَمْ يَكُنْ لَهُمْ شُهَدَاءَ إِلَّا أَنفُسُهُمْ فَشَهَادَةُ أَحَدِهِمْ أَرْبَعُ شَهَادَاتٍ بِاللَّهِ. For a man that accuses his wife of infidelity or of having a child outside of the marriage without proof except for a conviction he has in and within himself, فَشَهَادَةُ أَحَدِهِمْ أَرْبَعُ شَهَادَاتٍ بِاللَّهِ, the man will be asked to come forward, to present himself in front of a judge, a Sharia judge, present himself in front of the judge and bear witness on himself four times by Allah. He will bear witness by Allah that he is convinced that his wife has committed infidelity and that the child is not his. Innahu lamina sawadikin, he will bear witness that he is saying the truth against his wife. He will bear this witness four times by Allah. And the fifth time, walikhamisatu an la'anatallahi alayhi in kana min al-kazibin. He will swear upon himself, he will curse himself for the fifth time. He swears four times, and then the fifth time, he will lay a curse on himself that the wrath of Allah should come upon him if he is lying against her. So for one to go this route, he has to be extremely sure that this is the case. And if this is the case, the man has given witness four times and he has laid a curse upon himself if he's lying against her, the wife would also come forward, وَيَدْرَهُ أَنْهَا الْعَذَابِ. If she denies the allegation, the wife would also be asked to come forward and تَشْهَادَ أَرْبَعَ شَهَادَاتٍ بِاللَّهِ. They would also be required to swear by Allah four times. And the fifth time, she asked to swear by Allah four times that the man is lying against her. And the fifth time she will say, أَنَّ غَدَبَ اللَّهِ عَلَيْهَا إِنْ كَانَ مِنَ الصَّادِقِينَ, that the wrath of Allah should come upon her if truly the husband is telling the truth and she is the one lying. ثُمَّ يُفَرِّقُ بَيْنَهُمَا إِلَى الْأَبَدِ وَيُلْحِقُ الْوَلَدْ بِأُمِّهِ. After this is done between both of them, their marriage will be dissolved at that point and they shall never ever marry one another again. Whatever child that is in dispute would move with the mother. The child will go with the mother and the man will be on his own. They shall never get married to one another. They cannot come back together again to say, I made a mistake. Oh, I want to change my mind, I want to marry again, because the wrath of Allah is going to visit one of them. One of them must have lied against the other person, and they have both cursed themselves for the wrath of Allah to visit, to come upon both of them, or either of them that is lying. So that is that about that. The next right of the child, quickly, ri'ayatul abnahi wajibun ala al-walidain. The child, training of the child, care of the child is part of the right of the child over the parents. The care of the child is the right of that child. The care starts from when you give birth to the child, breastfeeding the child, taking care of the child, taking care of their security, their feeding. That is part of the care of the child. And this is the responsibility of both parents. وَلِلْ وَلَدْ عَلَىٰ أَبِيهِ وَأُمِّهِ حَقُّ رِعَايَةُ وَالتَّرْبِيَةُ. The right of care and the right of training over the parents, the child has that. وَعَلَىٰ أَبِيهِ فِي حَيَاتِهِ أَقْوَ النَّفَقَ. The child also has the right for the father to spend his money on him until he reaches the age where he can begin making money on his own and spending for himself. It is the right of the father, it is the responsibility of the father to spend on the child to take care of all of his needs. And then quickly, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, كُلُّكُمْ رَاعٍ وَكُلُّكُمْ مَسْؤُولٌ أَنْ رَعِيَّتِهِ, that all of you, you all are shepherds, and you all shall be asked about your herds on the day of Qiyamah. So you're a father, you have wives, and you have children. Your children and your wives are your herds, and you shall be asked about how you treated them. Did you fulfill your responsibilities over them? Did they get all of their rights from you? You will answer for that. As a mother, you also have a responsibility over your children and your husband's house, and you shall be asked for that. So everyone will give account for what they have responsibilities over. This is to say that all of our rights to our children has to be fulfilled. As part of the rights to care that the child has over the parents, we have the right of the child to be breastfed, the right of the child to be the right of custody of the child. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, remember the verse that we recited in the beginning where Allah says, do not kill your children for fear of poverty, because it is us that provide your sustenance and theirs. Part of the sustenance of the child that Allah provides is the breast milk that Allah puts in the chest of the mother. It is part of the sustenance of that child. That is why it is enough, it doesn't cost anything, but it is Allah that says it should flow and serve as food and have all the nutrients that child needs. So it is the right of that child to suck that breast and get the milk from there to be beneficial to them as Allah wills for them. It is not right for a mother to deny the child the right to suckle the breast for fear of maybe their own physical appearance. For a mother to say, I don't want my breast to flatten, and that's why you will not breastfeed your child. That is not allowed. That is not right. That will be denying the right of that child, and that is not allowed. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah Al-Baqarah, وَلِوَالِدَاتُ يُرْدِينَ أَوْلَادَهُنَّ حُلَيْنِ كَامِلَيْنِ لِمَنْ أَرَوْدَ أَنْ يُتِمَّ الرَّضَاعَةَ, upon the mother to breastfeed the child for 2 years for those who wish to complete the cycle of breastfeeding. Allah recommends 2 years. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala recommends 2 years of breastfeeding. If you do not have any good reason not to follow this rule, you will just... You're just being, ungrateful to Allah. You're just being, you're just turning your back on Allah. If you don't have any good reason not to breastfeed your child, you should go ahead and breastfeed your child, because it is a recommendation from Allah. And in fact, when you do so, you should do it for 2 years if you can. If you're not able to, just for the sake of time, I'm going to end it here. If you're not able to do this, if you have to cut it short less than 2 years, the scholars say there has to be an agreement between the father and the mother. If you're going to breastfeed the child for less than 2 years, it has to be an agreement between both of them. For Hakul Hadona, the right, who has the right of custody of a child and up to what time? It is said that the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, someday a woman came to the Prophet and said to him that my child, the one that lived in my womb for 9 months, my child, the one I built a connection with, the one that suckled my breast, is the only food that he knows. My child, the one who was taking my arm as a place of rest. My husband has divorced me, and my husband wants to take my child away from me. And Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, no, you have a right to your child more than he does until the time you choose to remarry. So for two people in a divorce, it is clear from the Sharia of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam that the mother has the right to custody of their child until and unless the mother marries another person. It is also said that during the khilafah of Abu Bakr radiyallahu anhu, Umar ibn al-Khattab radiyallahu anhu, when he divorced one of his wives, one of the women from the city of Medina that he married, and they had a child together. One day he was walking in the market, and he saw, and this one is to prove that up to what time can the mother have the custody of the child legally in Islamic law. So it was in the market, and he saw his ex-wife with his child. At this point, the child had stopped breastfeeding, and the child was walking on his own. That means this is no longer a small baby. And then Umar went to the his ex-wife and started pulling the child away from her. He wanted to take the child away from her that I think is old enough to go home with me now. So both of them were dragging the child back and forth. When Umar finally got a hold of the child started crying out loud. And Umar was saying, I have a right to this child. He has to go with me now because it doesn't depend on you anymore. And then they took themselves, both of them, they went to Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, who was the Khalif at the time, and they laid their case to him. And Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu said to Umar, that the mother has the right to that child at that point. And he said to him, Ri'uha wa firashuha wa hijruha khayrun lahu mink hatta yashubba wa yakhtaru li nafsihi. That everything that his mother has to provide for him is better for him at this time, until when he grows up to an age where he can choose, make a choice for himself, who he wants to live with. But until that time when he can make a choice for himself, the mother has custody according to Islamic law. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best. I pray to Almighty Allah to make everything we've heard and learned today beneficial to us in this life and in the hereafter. May Allah continue to increase us in beneficial knowledge and benefit from anything that we learn. ربنا آتنا في الدنيا حسنة وفي الآخرة حسنة وقنا عذاب النار. توفنا مسلمين وألحقنا بالصالحين. سبحانك اللهم وبحمدك. أشهد أن لا إله إلا أنت أستغفرك وأتوب إليك. أقول قولي هذا أستغفر الله لي ولكم. والسلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.
وعليكم السلام ورحمة الله وبركاته. جزاك الله خيرا. I don't know, maybe the mission board already make arrangement who's going to coordinate the role of Brother Sharif. If not, I will go ahead and ask anybody who have questions for our lecturer today, Imam Abdulaziz, if you have any question for him. Bismillah.
Jazakumullah. He actually asked me to play that role. So inshallah, I'll take you from here. Jazakumullah. Now, Sister Bukola. Sister Bukola, okay, we need to unmute you.
Assalamu alaikum wa
rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
My question is about when our lecturer was talking about we shouldn't be a mother our children for the fear of poverty. And he said, whatsoever name we call it abortion. So my question is, what if it's not for the fear of poverty, but probably I just had my baby 2 months or 3 months ago, and of course, as couples, you can stay away from each other. Am I supposed to continue doing this without any care and keep having baby month after month? Even though that's going to go under medical condition, that it's not even healthy for the mother and the child. So, sir, what do we do? And that's not for the fear of poverty, but of spacing.
Jazakum Allah khairan. Alhamdulillah, wa salatu wa salam ala rasulillahi wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallim. As I said, anything beyond the fear, anything outside the fear, or anything that has to do with the fear of poverty, that is forbidden. It cannot be for the sole fear of poverty. That Allah is clear about that in the Quran. If it is for health reasons, this is allowed. It is allowed to use contraceptive or other means if it is for health reasons, if it is a risk to the mother. And there's a lot of discussion, it's a whole topic on its own to talk about, especially for modern day technologies and the application of such and things that, you know, that has to do with conception and contraception and things like that. That's a whole different topic. So inshallah, hopefully Imam will get us to that point. And he has taught us that before, but inshallah, I think he'll come back to that topic. So if it is outside of the fear of poverty, this, again, on a case-by-case basis can be examined and it's probably allowed, but if it is poverty, and that is forbidden, and Allah knows best.
And my second question is about our rights over our kids. You said when we have a baby and want to do akiko, I think I've heard somewhere that it's compulsory, and I've also heard about baraka so many times. So my question is, the imam or the scholar that have your baby and pray or do the ECOMO or anything to your baby, does he have any impact? Like, does the albarica, I don't know how to put the question, does the caliber or the kind of how virtuous the scholar is, does it affect or does it go along with the child? I get question, Misa. Albarica, no. Okay.
Alhamdulillah, wa salatu wa salamu ala rasulullah. So the reason that this has been practiced, and it is not compulsory, there's nothing compulsory about it, but people practice this by looking for a righteous person, a God-fearing person, or a scholar that, again, a scholar that is righteous and God-fearing, because it is known that during the time of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, people will bring their newborn babies to him, and he would offer things like tanik, and he would recite the azan in their ears, because, again, it is a right for the father, but that he can delegate. And the father can do it and still delegate it if he knows someone who is a pious, God-fearing person. It can be delegated to them also. Again, because the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was known to be a pious person, and people will bring their children to him. And al-ulama warasatul anbiya. It is known that the scholars are the inheritors of the prophets. So that is why people practice this tradition to say people took their children to the Prophet because he was a pious man. If you know a pious person, you can also take your children there. To them, to pray for them, to do tanik, and to recite the azan in their ears. Talking about barakah, no one controls barakah, only Allah controls barakah. But it is the belief that when a pious person prays for you, or you know, has something to do with asking Allah on your behalf, that Allah would accept such prayers, and that is what that is about. So there's nothing compulsory again about calling the scholars for aqiqah. It's just a practice that people take up as part of what the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam did during his time. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best.
There is one question online, please.
Yeah, I see a question in the chat that says, assalamu alaikum, how can a man who believes his child isn't his balance the hadith that states that the child belongs to the owner of the bed with accusing his wife of zina and automatically relinquishing his rights to the child? What is better for him to do? Accept the child as is or give up on the child? If it is clear to a person that the child is not his, because a child that is not of one's, that is, you know, DNA today, the only reason you can say you are clear is maybe because of DNA. That's the only way one can be clear outside of having witnesses to support zina. If one is clear based on the DNA, the man again cannot be forced to accept a child that he believes is not his own. So if you have a DNA result, knowing that the DNA result cannot be 100% accurate, we've seen cases where people have a child and the child was swapped in the hospital. The woman took home a baby that was not us because a baby was swapped by mistake with another person. And maybe that baby grows up and they do a DNA test, and the husband finds out he's not his child, accuses his wife, who's a pious woman, of fornication, and that would not be the case. So we cannot rely on DNA. That is why it is best to not speculate enough to go that route, to try to find out that, because you might find that which will not please you. If Allah has kept it Eden, it should stay Eden, because it will cause fitna if you find out what you don't know, what you should not find out there. Again, it could be a case where child was swapped, your wife is not necessarily, and if you go the route of swearing, which is the only route you have to claim, to show, to prove that the child is not yours and that your wife probably fornicated, she's sure she did not, you think she did because you have DNA result, you place the curse of Allah on one another, the curse will come upon you because you would have lied against her because you don't have proof. For a Muslim, if your only reason for wanting to do DNA is to find out if the child is yours, you should stay clear of that and not go that route, because again, fitna. But if you do and you feel convinced, you have to go the route of what is called a lihaf, which is the one where you place it, where you give testimony by Allah four times and you place a curse upon yourself if you are lying against your wife. And your wife will do the same, and that marriage would be dissolved, and she will go away with the child. And you will have the peace of mind that you're asking for, which should not be the case if you just stay clear of speculation to begin with. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best. I guess that will be the last question we take. It's iftar time. Alhamdulillah for bringing us to the end of today's fasting. We ask Allah to accept our fasting. We ask Allah to bless us and grant us His full rewards in this life and hereafter. We call on Imam to please give us a closing dua. Jazakumullah.